Good morning and welcome to the 15th meeting of 2024 in Session 6 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. We have received apologies from Annie Wells. This morning we'll be taking evidence on the Disability Commissioner Scotland Bill from two witness panels. I refer members to papers 1 and 2 and I welcome to the meeting our first panel. We have Lynn Pornaro, Chief Executive Officer of Disability Equality Scotland, Teresa Burke, Chief Executive Officer, and Karen Wiley, Policy and Participation Manager of Glasgow Disability Alliance. Heather Fiskin, Chief Executive of Inclusion Scotland, is joining us remotely. We have Dr. Polly Nolan, Head of Policy Engagement, Inclusion Scotland, and Jenny Miller, Chief Executive of PAMIS, Promoting a More Inclusive Society. You're all very welcome and thank you for attending this morning. We are quite tight for time, so we will go straight into questions. And the first question is from myself. And it's to ask your thoughts on the bill itself and do you agree with the general principles of it? And I would like to go to Heather Fiskin, please, first.
Hello, thank you very much. I apologise for not being with you in person. I was defeated by the M8 this morning and had to rush home, so I appreciate that the staff at the Parliament have managed to accommodate that so well. So firstly, in terms of the bill itself as it stands, we are a membership organisation and we are a disabled persons organisation run by disabled people themselves. I think the first thing I want to say is that we consulted our members and we recognised through the results of that survey that there was roughly 75% outright in favour of the bill and 25% raised concerns about it. And a key concern of both types of respondents was that it's a very crowded landscape and there was potentially a lack of clout in the bill, in the proposals that we consulted on back in the day. And one of the things I would say right at the beginning, and I think my other DPO colleagues, Lynn and Tressa, will probably support this, is that one of the reasons why there is so much support for the bill is that there is such a great need. There has been so little change, so little positive movement in terms of disabled people's rights. We recognise, however, that the bill does lack clout in the sense that while there is an investigatory power proposed, there is no enforcement action behind that. So I'm happy to pass to my other colleagues here now, recognising that we're short of time and there are four organisations represented here today. Thank you.
Thank you, Heather. I will now go on to Jenny, please.
Yeah, I totally agree with Heather. I support families and carers of people who have a profound learning and multiple complex disabilities. And while I think our families recognise that there is an absolute need for something because there are so many issues that they're facing at the moment, I think we're really concerned about this very small niche group. We were absolutely invisible during COVID and we feel that we could be very invisible within a very crowded landscape. It's a very, very broad remit. I think additionally, my worry is that we're having to look at all of these commissioners because people are so unhappy with what they're receiving at the moment and feel they have nowhere to go when things go wrong. But my concern and our concern is what happens, what clout does that commissioner have? What happens when there have been reviews that have been looked at and recommendations made, but there seems to be a real so what factor and who will have the clout to actually take forward any future improvements? I think our other concern was because it's so broad, you know, what does best practice look like for such a diverse group and how will, I mean, it would have to be a pretty enormous organisation to take on board all the best practice for all the different groups that it would be representing. So although I just think it's very sad, actually, that we have to think about having so many commissioners because we're just not getting it right within the services that we're providing.
Thank you, Jenny. Dr. Nolan, please.
Yeah, I would say exactly the same things, really. There was a comment about, you know, why is money being put into a commissioner when we consulted disabled people, excuse me, why is money being put into a commissioner and when it could be spent on services? Now, I'm not suggesting that that's how funding works, but it does raise the question of where so much improvement is required of services for disabled people across the board, and it's not happening. And for example, Scottish Human Rights Commission are reviewing the Coming Home report at the moment. The Coming Home implementation plan was due to deliver from April this year, and yet it hasn't. So they're looking at it through the lens of human rights and doing research on that and why that hasn't happened. There's so many that I think I'll go back to what Heather raised, was there's the cluttered landscape already where commissioners have responsibility, and we don't want to lose that, and yet actually some of them maybe aren't making the most of that responsibility as well. So it is really difficult to come to a clear view on support for a disability commissioner when we know that a lot of disabled people want it, and yet it's based on this need, this huge need. Thank you.
Thank you. Karen Wiley, please.
Thanks. So obviously the GDA, we're a member-led organisation, so we have consulted extensively with our members on this, and I would say they are broadly supportive of having a disability commissioner. They appreciate that it would be very useful to perhaps have one champion advocating and focusing very much specifically on the rights of disabled people. And obviously that could be valuable. However, it has to be caveated with many of the sort of same concerns that have already been raised there. This bill has to have absolute teeth. There has to be real powers that could not make real change for disabled people. It has to be properly resourced, particularly because disabled people must be involved in the work of the commission. With the commissioner, so it would have to be properly resourced to allow for full meaningful participation. And also, obviously, our members are aware of the Scottish Human Rights Commission and the Equality and Human Rights Commission, and that obviously they are monitoring and keeping an eye on human rights of all people. But I think, obviously, disabled people, they have been so deprioritised, particularly with the disproportionately impacted by COVID, the cost of living crisis, 15 years of austerity. So I think there's a feeling that disabled people's rights are so far back. We're not on a level playing field. We're not starting at the same at the same kind of point as perhaps other people, other groups who are whose rights are being protected. And so I think that's that comes across really strongly from our members. The feeling that perhaps somebody that can be a champion for them is really important, just because of how far back disabled people feel they are at the moment.
Thank you. Tressa Burke, please.
I would just agree with everything that's been said so far about the complexity and the potentially cluttered landscape, particularly building on Karen's views. Disabled people fared so badly during the pandemic. They were the highest number of people who died were disabled people. 80% of our members, and we surveyed and particularly spoke directly to over 6,000 people, where a helpline as well as phoning our members. Over 80% didn't know where to turn for support. Despite all the wonderful community support that rose up at that time, 60% were digitally excluded. Almost half were worried about money, and that's got much, much worse. 82% were socially isolated and felt that loneliness was absolutely crushing. And these are before the cost of living kicked in. So I suppose, having thought long and hard about it and spoken to members about it, yes, they want a champion. Yes, they want an advocate. They want somebody to defend and protect rights. But as Karen said, and as others have said, it would need to have teeth. Aware of the fiscal situation and context, and knowing that the Finance and Public Administration Committee is looking at this as well, I would suggest that the amount of money that's been developed in the proposal and the financial memorandum is not enough. The number of staff wouldn't be enough either. You would absolutely need somebody looking at participation. You would need legal people. You would need investigative people as well for this to actually have any real weight. But even then, the cost of all of that is a drop in the ocean when you're trying to turn the tankard of inequality and discrimination that disabled people face in every part of their lives, including in the delivery of public services. And it will take something like a disability commissioner with a focus and the platform, the spotlight and the ability to promote and develop good practice, but hopefully do more than investigate, to actually take legal cases, working with a memorandum of understanding with the other institutions, the other human rights and equalities bodies. I think the feeling of our members was extremely strong, but they're not fools either. They know that there's a cluttered landscape. They know that there's financial constraints, but their desperation is such, and the dehumanisation and the deprioritisation and the lack of political leadership in actually allocating resources to change disabled people's lives, when we're left with asking the question, if not a disability commissioner, what? What are we going to do and who's going to do it? Because all the commissions that were given evidence, they had a great critique of why this might not work, but I would like to meet with them and with all of you in a separate context to actually take forward a plan for Scotland. We've been trying to work with the government for 16 months now on what was an immediate priorities plan to address disabled people's poverty and inequality. 16 months later, we're still not near publishing, and that's because there's no resources being committed. We can actually get political leadership and buy-in, and we were almost there, and then there was a change of First Minister, and so we need to rebuild and rebuild and rebuild. But the thing is, disabled people have been dehumanised and deprioritised. Going back, I mean, there's a professor from Caledonia University who's written an anthology about this, taking us back to Plato and Aristotle about the othering and the dehumanising of disabled people throughout the whole of history, throughout the whole of time, and that's just what's happening here. So we have a serious, serious problem, and we need to do something about it. And GDA members, members of Glasgow Disability Alliance, are willing to put their bet on a disability commissioner as a good way of progressing that because of the spotlight and the focus.
Thank you, Trissa. Lynn Pernaro, please.
Thank you. Disability Equality Scotland is also a membership organisation. And like what my colleagues have said, the majority are supportive of a disability commissioner for the fact that there is nowhere to turn. And although as a disabled people organisation and as DPOs across Scotland, we are advocating on behalf of our members to get their voices heard, to have them participating, etc. But it is closed door after closed door after closed door, or we have an open door and we get all the right words that come back, but then there is no action. And that's what our members want. They want action. They want to be participating within everyday life across Scotland, have the same opportunities as others, but they have been disregarded over and over again. And quite a lot of them are almost given up the fight. What's the point any longer? And the fact that there is this proposal for a disability commissioner, it's reinvigorated them to think, well, would this make a difference? And as everybody else has said, it needs to be properly resourced financially, but also the powers that the commissioner has given, you know, to investigate, fine, but it needs to be holding people accountable and making that change. Otherwise, we've got another person standing up talking for disabled people, but nothing else actually happens and changes. Members broadly supporting it overall, with the caveats. And they also were very strong about the caveat that should a disability commissioner come into place, that must be a disabled person.
Okay, thank you. We'll now move on to questions from Maggie Chapman, please.
Thanks very much, Karen, and good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us this morning and for what you've said so far. I just want to explore, you've all talked about the cluttered landscape and maybe the difficulties that disabled people might have in finding a route for the person who can help them. And I'm just wondering how you think, given that landscape, given the potential for duplication of powers, of mandate that a disability commissioner would have compared to other commissioners that exist, or indeed other organisations. How do you see that as we try and work through that, how do you see this specific proposal dealing with not only the cluttered landscape, but the potential for duplication and overlap of mandate and action from the point of view of disabled people themselves? And Lynn, if I can start with you on this.
I think so one of the things that would have to happen is, you know, disability doesn't, it's not in a silo. People have lots of additional responsibilities and intersectional protected characteristics within themselves as human beings, and therefore disability commissioner would need to work closely with other commissioners and, you know, stop the working in silos, so that actually we can see disabled people for the people that they are, rather than, oh, they're disabled. So, because we don't want that, we want to be able to just be, that's Lynn, that's, you know, Maggie. It's not, oh, that's Lynn, who's a disabled person, so we'll put her into that box there. So disability commissioner would be obviously standing up for and promoting and, you know, hopefully making change to our human rights and the additional human rights that disabled people require to be able to live that full life. But actually, they need to work alongside other commissioners and other organisations that are all doing the same work as well, because we're not just a silo.
Okay, thanks, Lynn. That's very clear. Tressa and Karen, if I can come to you, GDA's view on this. Tressa, you spoke very powerfully, you know, saying disabled people, this is their, what they're going to bet on. How do you see that potential overlap, duplication of effort, that the complication of route, if a disabled person is looking for remedy, who do they go to? SHRC, Disability Commissioner, EHRC, where would they go? How would you see that all working out?
So I think the first thing I would say is that accessibility is a major issue for disabled people, and being able to identify and a champion, somebody who is going to take their issues forward, is really important. So we've heard from the other commissions about limitations, whether it's about areas of law or whether it's about not having the resources or the right, the power to do participation work. So presumably this commissioner is going to be able to do participation work. So that would be the first thing that disabled people would actually be able to approach the disability commissioner. The disability commissioner would be dealing with disabled people of all different types of impairments and conditions, and disabled people who experience marginalisation because of the way society responds to protected characteristics that they have. So I'm obviously speaking about intersectionality there. So, you know, there are organisations doing brilliant intersectional work. If GDA can work intersectionally, a disability commissioner can definitely do that. I think what disabled people would be able to get from a commissioner is the engagement, the dialogue, but what we want more than the participation is, and more than the investigation, is the ability to take cases, is the ability to actually to legally challenge as well. So we would want additional things, and GDA members have been really clear about that. They are fully supportive, but with caveats that it has some power. And looking at the financial memorandum, as I said a minute ago, I don't think that it's properly resourced to do those things at this point. So again, just finally to say that they would need to have memorandum of understanding with the other commissions. And I would also add that although the other commissions are doing wonderful work and they do the best they can within the limitations that they have, it is not the case that they are making a difference after all of these years to the lives of disabled people. And that is what the challenge that has been put back from our members. They want a disability commissioner because they want a commission to be able to intervene and make a difference to their lives and improve their lives.
Can I just explore that point a little bit further? So, I mean, I think it's clear you've all said that we're in this situation because disabled people have been failed by existing bodies, by every structure, probably not delivering, not supporting them appropriately. And I suppose we've also heard quite clearly that the points you've made about this needs to have clout, this needs to have teeth. How do we ensure then that if we get a disability commissioner with the clout, with the teeth and with the resources, how do you see that working with some of the other, and I know you've mentioned memorandums of understanding, but how, given that the SHRC's and the EHRC's mandates are different as well, do you see any problem with the Disability Commissioner potentially having more powers than the national human rights institutions, whether it's SHRC or EHRC? Tracy, do you have a view on that?
I mean, I have a really clear view on this. I have heard the argument about hierarchies of rights. Mm-hmm. I think this is about addressing a hierarchy of oppression and the fact that disabled people are the furthest removed from having the most basic human rights. We have members who, during the pandemic, didn't have a shower for more than 2 years, have been told they only need so many showers a year, once a month. I mean, these are genuine stories that our members are telling us, the lived experience. When people don't have the basic choices or control over their lives, I think that the country that we live in, a dignified, civilised country like Scotland, with the resources we have, should be able to take action to address that. So I'm not so worried about the arguments about hierarchies of rights. I think we should be looking to target and tackle those that have the least rights. So I'll stop.
Yeah, there. No. That's very clear. Thank you. I'll move on, if I may, to Heather. Similar question for you, Heather, around the duplication and overlap of potential mandates and powers, and how you would see that working out.
Thank you very much. Could I just return the question in a sense that if the landscape is so busy, why has there been no change so far? And Tress has answered that, which is really good. I think also the fact that we live in an information age. There is so much information out there. People just don't know where to go anymore. For disabled people, that's even harder. Because so much information is online and we have documented digital poverty. And so much of that information, even if you do have access to the digital world, is inaccessible. I think also it's worth saying that there is no bespoke focus on disabled people. And we've outlined already, how complex this is, intersectionality, the entrenchment of disabled people's lack of human rights. I do think that the commissions who do a lot of good work within the capacities that they have are very alert to the complications, and they will work with MOUs and recognise this. I think it's more a case of they're bolstering each other, they're supporting each other. If you had a disability commissioner, then that person would have that laser focus and be able to assist the other commissions in the work they do. One of the things, we've noticed that the bill does not include enforcement powers for the disability commissioner alongside the investigative powers. However, one of the things that the commissions can do is they can publicly name and shame, if you like, organisations who are failing that they've investigated. And if this bill goes ahead and a disability commissioner is put in place, I hope that is something they will do. And I hope it is something they will do to great effect, so that the lessons are learned across the wider sector, across society. So yes, it is going to be a complicated landscape. And I think it's important that not just the commissions, but the people in Scotland have clarity on how to use that landscape, which again goes back to my point about the information age. But if a disability commissioner came online, then their role would be partly that, how to make the commission landscape, the wider commission landscape, accessible and relevant and beneficial for disabled people.
Thanks very much, Heather. That's very clear. And finally, Jenny, if I can come to you. You spoke in your answer to Karen's earlier question around the breadth that this could and arguably should cover. How do you see How do you see that one organisation or one commissioner with a commission behind them dealing with the complexities and the variation across the range of needs and requirements that disabled people have, given the overlaps, classic landscape, those kinds of issues we've touched on.
I think it is definitely an area of concern, but listening to colleagues, you know, maybe we just haven't got it right yet, and maybe profound means deep, wise expert, and people that have a profound learning disability are the best educators that we have, because they can't communicate in ways that we normally do, and you have to use all your senses to listen to them. But what they do teach us is that nobody has the answer. Everybody needs to collaborate, and when we collaborate together, then we begin to get it right. And maybe we need to take a lesson from them and their family carers. I mean, our family carers have been around all the commission as trying to get support and finding that they haven't got an answer because people haven't had teeth. But maybe we just don't have the answer. But if we collaborate and we look at a commissioner model where we all learn to work together, then perhaps we'll come up with something that will work. Because people that have a physical disability also require the Mental Welfare Commission, or they have their human rights that's needing to be met. So maybe we've just not got it right yet, but we could look at commissioners working together across the whole spectrum, and then we would manage to include everybody. But I think listen with all our senses.
Thank you. I think it's very easy to get channeled into a particular form of communication, isn't it, and miss so much of what else is going on. I could go on, but I know you want to get through things, so thank you all.
Okay, thanks Maggie. We'll now move on to questions from Paul O'Kane, please.
Okay, thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. And I suppose I'm going to expand on some of the themes we've been talking about there in terms of potential duplication and those sorts of issues. I'm very conscious that we have a proposal before the Parliament in terms of a bill on learning disability, autism, neurodivergence. And indeed, within that, there's a question about should there be a commissioner in this space. And I know that many of the organisations represented today have been supportive of those proposals. Some have obviously raised different views and concerns. But I suppose the first question I would have really is on this issue of a growing landscape of commissioners. And I think Jenny had touched on some of that in one of her previous responses. But keen to understand, you know, are you concerned that we will begin to fragment within the kind of wider disability sphere as well? So seeing as I mentioned it, I may start with Jenny, if that's all right, just for maybe your view on that.
I mean, I think I would be concerned, and I think that there is a real risk, particularly if we're setting commissioners up to compete with each other. But I think I'd go back to saying I think we maybe need to just relook at that model, and we need to think about how we get people to work together and collaborate. And I think all of the commissions, and I certainly do quite a bit with the Mental Welfare Commission, and the reference group there all talk about having more teeth and more power. So I think there's probably a real desire for people to do things and to make more of a difference. But I go back to, I think we haven't got the model right. And I think if we are going down, I mean, we've also obviously put in a response to the LDAN bill. And the concern there is that there is so much that is wrong. We're going to have to do something to make it right. But I know that people with disabilities and family carers are hanging on having a commissioner because they feel it's the only route to make a difference. So it's how we collectively work together, I think, to try and think about how we make sure that it doesn't become fragmented. And that, I mean, we all support each other in different ways. And I know that if I'm not at an organisation, people do talk about this very tiny group of people with profound learning disabilities who are invisible. But you know, it's by working collaboratively that we'll all be able to make a difference.
Thank you for that. I wonder if anyone would like to give a broader view on that issue around commissioners and maybe too many commissioners within the landscape or those sorts of things.
So, you know, we recognise, I mean, we are a pan-impairment organisation, which means that we work with all disabled people. And often I think because we describe ourselves as a disabled people's organisation, people sort of think, oh, that's people with physical impairments. That's people, yeah. But we work with everyone from people with addictions, people with mental health conditions, people with learning disabilities, autistic people and neurodivergent people. And we have autistic people's organisations and disabled people's organisations of people with learning disability as members of our organisation. And they have mixed views on a commissioner. They support the learning disability and neurodivergence bill to an extent that there is such great need, again, and it's parallels with this, to the extent that, you know, things like education is very inaccessible for this group of people, access to justice and so on. But you have that across the board for all disabled people. So it's very difficult to come to a view. There are specific issues, though, for which perhaps it might be necessary to have that commissioner. So, for example, things like coming home, although you've got the SHRC doing that at the moment, doing that work. So, yeah, it is a really difficult question. We go by the United Nations General Comment 7, which says that there needs to be resources for disabled people's organisation that are diverse, but pan-disabled people's organisations do represent all disabled people, and we do our best to do that, including those that are hardest to reach, and so-called hardest to reach. Yeah, I'll finish there. I'm sorry, does anyone else have a view on this?
Just kind of to follow on from what you're saying there, also Glasgow Disability Alliance is also a pan-impairment organisation, and so we have hundreds of members who have learning disabilities, for instance, and so this, you know, we would support a commissioner, you know, specifically for that. But perhaps, and one of the questions that in the submissions for the on the consultation for this was about the definition of disability, and we and the fact that it's at the moment using the Equality Act definition, but we were concerned that perhaps that's kind of taking it down more of a kind of medical model of disability, whereas we would use a social model. And so rather than perhaps looking at, you know, people's the particular impairments or conditions that people are having and what would a commissioner be looking at, it's more broadly having to look at the barriers that people are facing. And that could also go for other, you know, other groups as well, because as mentioned, you know, GDA, we work in an intersectional way. So we have, you know, BAME disabled people, LGBT disabled people of all ages and so on. So it's kind of looking maybe more at the barriers faced by people rather than the individual conditions or impairments.
Yeah, I'd say.
Can I pick up on
that?
To say that I think that the reasoning behind why people are asking for that is sound, really sound. The stats are awful and the life outcomes for people with learning difficulties and neurodiverse people. However, it could be not a blunt tool because it is right in what they're saying, but if you had a disability commissioner that was looking through the lens of the social model of disability and looking at the barriers as has been described, what we found was, for example, I'll give you an example, the shielding criteria, it missed people who had intersecting conditions that made them extremely vulnerable. And I think that this is the same position that we're in here. So LDAN is in itself a good thing without a doubt, but as long as the Disability Commissioner takes account of the additional disadvantage and stigma and oppression that people experience who have learning difficulties and neurodiversity, as well as other disabled people, then it would hopefully be met through a Disability Commissioner. But we would not dissent from supporting that bill because we support the people, but it's quite complicated, as you said. It's really difficult to separate that out, so we don't want not to support it, just in case this one doesn't happen. But this one should also be able to address that, because it should be looking at oppression and intersecting oppressions and intersectionality, and if it does that right, it would cover the people in this group as well.
I mean, I wonder, because we touched briefly there on the role of the Mental Welfare Commission in some of these spaces. The Scottish Human Rights Commission has given evidence. And I think we've spoken more broadly about the need for that intersectionality, but also I think not becoming too siloed and trying to work across the space. So is there a sense that these organisations need to have perhaps more resource or more input from people who have a disability, or, you know, is there more we can do in the broader landscape without a commissioner, or is it a bit of a mix of all of these things? Because going back to Jenny's original point, I think about, you know, we need to improve across the board in terms of what is on offer and what we're kind of moving through. So I don't know if anyone has a view on that.
Yeah.
Pauline.
So it's going back to that laser focus that people have been talking about. So what these commissioners do, what these other commissioners do, can be quite good, so some better than others. So, for example, the EASS is an advisory, equality advisory service for the whole of the UK, and over 70% of the calls for that come from disabled people, inquiries about their rights, inquiries about things like poverty, social security, lots of different areas. And yet, in 2017, the Equalities and Human Rights Commission across the UK disbanded the Disability Committee of that organisation. So it took away that focus on disabled people, despite them being one of the most oppressed groups across the board. And so we're not saying that, you know, there's no place for looking. We absolutely support the place for these other commissioners to work with a disability commissioner to look at specific issues as they affect disabled people, and they mustn't take that focus away, particularly where they're looking at the equalities impacts of different multiple groups and intersectional impacts. But we do require that laser focus. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. We have a supplementary on this from Megan Gallagher, please.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning, panel. And it is on the point that Paul O'Kane was raising in relation to other commissioners that should be carrying out work to help and support and promote people with disabilities and living with disabilities. And I was interested in terms of the call for views, because an Inclusion Scotland member stated within the calls for views that they were very aware of the Children's Commissioner, the SHRC and the EHRC. They all do work to promote and protect disabled children and adults' rights, however, all have a wider responsibility that sometimes mean that disabled people's rights are not their first priority. So even though the SHRC's remit could be strengthened and the EHRC's remit could be strengthened, do you still feel that there would be a gap for disabled people? Because of that, do you think, therefore, that a disability commissioner is essential? And if I could start with Inclusion Scotland, please. Heather, sorry.
Hello, thank you. Yes, I think it goes back to what we both said in previous answers. It's about having that laser focus. It is about developing that understanding. It's about having that direct connection with disabled people and disabled people's organisations. Can I just add a sidebar here? That it will be important for the Commissioner to work with disabled people's organisations as well as disabled people. We already do a lot of work in this area, but we are few and far between, and we are very stretched as well. So it's the complexity of it. And, you know, our staff and our board members are disabled people. We get it. It doesn't require this long, drawn-out explanation every time somebody says, oh, this is happening. We understand it. That takes quite a lot of time to develop that, because I can't speak for every disabled person in Scotland. I don't have their exact lived experience, but we are inured as organisations in that lived experience. And, you know, sometimes I'm sure there's been evidence to committees in the Scottish Parliament about this before, that when people were applying for benefits, etc., they in the past they were having to tell their life story time and time again to various officials. It's getting rid of all that unnecessary burden of information that disabled people have, the number of professionals they have in their lives. So having that single point with that developed and evolving and developing expertise on this. And of course, we've made the point as well that the Commissioner should be a disabled person themselves.
No, thank you. I don't know if anyone's got any further comments to make on that. No, Convener, I just think that's a really important point, actually, in terms of lived experience, because I know that's a phrase we use a lot in this committee, but actually it shows how important it is with these organisations in terms of what the aims of this bill is. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, absolutely.
Just building on what Heather said as well, it's about the fact that the Disability Commissioner could or should be a disabled person. You know, there was a study produced by What Works Scotland in 2017, and it was about engaging people that were previously, you know, considered to be hard to reach. And they spoke about the know-how of skilled practitioners. And I think that's kind of what Heather's getting at. I think if you had... Your question is about, could the existing commissions do it? And I want to say, why haven't they?
Yeah.
Because they have got some powers, but I do appreciate there are limitations in both the SHRC and the HRC. I do appreciate that we're not absolutely immune to having a conversation about maybe could the SHRC actually host something like a disability commissioner and related staff. But I think the important thing is that it is an area of expertise based on the lived experience of disabled people and their ideas and contributions about solutions, because disabled people know best what will work, but we can't do it on our own. We can't, you know, because we're talking to ourselves. We need to be collaborating with other people, hopefully power holders, politicians, decision makers, and these commissions as well. So if this was going to be located as a money-saving thing and to unclutter the landscape or make it less complicated, we would need to be convinced that it was going to be sufficiently resourced and enabled to become expert in these issues, because it would also need legal advice, as I said earlier, and investigators who actually understand about these issues, not just the generalists. Because what one of the things that I picked up, and I've possibly got it wrong, but my understanding from what Jan was saying in her evidence was that they have to work on all human rights, and that's a really important principle in human rights. Well, that's fine and that's great, but we specifically want to target these people, disabled people, whose human rights are so far back and so regressed. And we know the UN report of 2024, we've not only not addressed grave and systematic violations from 2017, we've actually got worse as a country, as a nation. So it's the UK and the devolved administrations. So we really need to think about that, and we need skilled practitioners, wherever they are, doing that work.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Thank you. And now move on to questions from Marie McNair, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. The committee is kind of looking to hear the panel's thoughts with regards to the kind of financial and resource estimates in the financial memorandum. And Dreza, you touched on my question earlier, and I kind of got the feeling that you had much more to say, but you're probably constrained with time. And also, I think it was your organisation that raised concerns that funding required for the Disability Commissioner could be diverted away, from other public policies aimed at disabled people. So I wanted to give you the opportunity to come in on that again before I move on to other members.
Yeah, so I suppose... I don't know if my microphone... Yeah,
you're on.
Is that okay? So when I looked at the financial memorandum, I was particularly interested in that because I run an organisation which engages and does highly participative work with disabled people every year. Our budget probably will be down this year, but in the last few years it's been about 1.2 million. And we, you know, I noticed, for example, it was up to £85,000 in what looks like, people might not understand it, it looks like, you know, marketing, but it's about engagement and participation. And I was thinking, our budget might be higher than that for Glasgow only. So this is the whole of Scotland. And I appreciate that the nature of the work we are doing is community development work. So we're building people and we're delivering services and supports as well. So it is different. But I felt quite strongly that it was an underestimation of the cost that you would need to do the work meaningfully and properly. And all the staff that should be in it aren't in it either. So I think the key thing, I mean, one of the things, again, that came out in the evidence that we reviewed previously from the commissions was about the SHRC not having the power for participation. But with that comes a high degree of cost if you're going to do it right, and if you're going to include disabled people, and if you're going to do it the length and breadth of Scotland, and if they're going to have open access to you, how are they going to get there? What are the channels? What is the... I mean, even just as simple as many wonderful anti-poverty organisations just now are doing great campaigns, and they've got online tools for helping people living in poverty to vote. but we've had to do a whole scale mail out to almost 6,000 people, which costs upwards of $5,000 just to do that mail out. So when you think about $85,000 as being a lot, maybe not so much, and there's other costs that I think aren't there either.
Thanks for that. It feels as if, in a way, you know, to do the good work, it's constrained, you know, in terms of, you know, by finance, you know. Yeah. Is anybody else wanting to come in and share their views on it?
I know your question's specifically on finance, but I think another important thing to think about as well is the kind of the other resources, the time, the capacity, the energy that could go into a disability commissioner. And one thing that our members were concerned about is that this is kind of seen as an easy win. It's something quick that can be done, and there you've got your figurehead, and it takes away the time and energy from, we've touched on, you know, the disability equality strategy that's meant to be getting worked on the immediate priorities plan that's now the initial action plan and so on. So as well as the financial resources and so on, I think that, you know, there's a bigger picture there as well that needs to be considered.
Thank you.
I think it's that breadth of individuals, you know, getting to know a group of people that have a profound learning disability takes time. Engaging with them takes even longer, and having meaningful consultation takes time. But that takes a huge breadth of skill as well. So you're going to need a very, very diverse group of people that work within that organisation if you're going to engage with the breadth of people with disabilities.
Yeah, and I think, you know, you need to consider the costs of Heather touched on it. Tressa touched on it. Going out to people in remote rural places, how they might engage, getting actually, you know, feedback from those groups of people on how they do it, because, you know, one part of Skye might have a community centre that's inaccessible, whereas another part does, but it's impossible to get that on public transport. Doing things hybrid, making sure, you know, you're doing bespoke engagement. And it's the costs of ensuring it's accessible. There's a communications accessibility standard in Scotland that's, you know, and that's absolutely has to be kept to. It's not a question. It's you have to cost that. You have to budget that. And so there's insufficient funding in that financial memorandum for that sort of support that people will require to engage.
Thank you, that's been really helpful.
Heather would like to comment on this. Heather?
Thank you. So I would just like to first of all really back up what other people have said about the cost of engagement, but I won't expand on that. I think that's been a good answer, and it should never be underestimated. One of the things that struck me from the financial memorandum was the amount of money allocated to publicity and promotion, and yes, this costs money. It's whether or not it actually has impact. Within the text of the financial memorandum, it refers to a short-term advertising campaign. Well, the impact of that kind of thing can be very short-term. And it's something I think that the commissioner, if they are in place, should look at very carefully. I'm also concerned, and I think it was Tressa who alluded to this, about the idea of money being diverted away from other work. And we've spoken about the challenges, and I'm sure you'll be aware of the challenges facing the wider third sector, but also the challenges facing disabled people's organisations, all our suppliers for communication support or personal assistance. Their costs are all going up. The cost of venues in the hospitality industry and the accessible ones that we would really agree to use, their costs are all going up. And it's the point about the work that we do as disabled people's organisations to build that capacity for disabled people to influence and be decision makers themselves, and to be at the decision making table. And with that work, we would hopefully not see a depreciation of the Equality and Human Rights Fund, which we rely on to continue our work with disabled people who are our board and our members. Thank you.
Thanks, Marie. Now move on to questions from Evelyn Tweed, please.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, panel, and thanks for all your answers so far. It's been very illuminating. I'm going to play a bit of devil's advocate, because what you've said is that generally the Disability Commissioner is needed. A figurehead a champion laser-like focus. However, it seems from the answers there's going to be a lot on this person's shoulders. You're looking for them to deliver a lot. And when I look at what's in the bill, you know, I'm kind of thinking, is it too much? Is it too much for one commissioner to deal with? And when you look at, there might be fiscal challenges. I mean, the Scottish Government has set aside, what, £1 million in the first year. And Teresa, other people have said, this isn't going to touch it. So would one way to be to look at it, like, we do need the commissioner to do the figurehead, the overarching work, but should there be a consideration that some of the work goes elsewhere to some of the organisations that already exist? And the SHRC has already been talked about as having a bigger role. Who would like to come in?
It is a big role, but there's 1 in 5 of us in Scotland that are disabled. There's a lot of us. And the reason that I believe our members and other members are kind of pinning their hopes on this is because so far we don't have anybody fighting for us in the manner that we need. The Equality Act has failed disabled people across the UK. The human rights organisations do amazing work, but disabled people are kind of put to the side, that disability protected characteristic. If we had the organisations that are currently there, if we had the commissioners that are currently there, and if we had the Scottish Government, who's currently in post, fighting for disabled people and speaking up for disabled people regularly, that focus would be on that. And I believe that those other organisations wouldn't see, we'll do this, we'll do that, oh, what about disabled people? All right, at the end. Because that's what happens. And we see this in our roles day in and day out, that whether it's public services, whether it's local government, whether it's the local shops on the high street, it's like, oh, well, we can't really do that for that. We can't really do this for this. So we'll just concentrate on the majority. So at what point do we have to get disabled people to be classed as a majority? We are the biggest minority group within the UK, within Scotland, and yet we're ignored over and over again. And this hasn't just been happening over the pandemic. It's not just been happening over cost of living. We're going back years and decades and decades and decades, as Tressa mentioned, goes way, way back. But when the Disability Discrimination Act came in, that was a win for disabled people. And there was a hope then that actually that would move things forward and the focus wouldn't be on that silos. There's disabled people. We'll focus on the non-disabled people, thought that we would come together at that point, and it hasn't happened, and it continues not to happen. And, you know, disabled people are dying because there isn't that focus. You know, we've got the human rights bill, you know, going around as well just now, and not to divert away from the Disability Commissioner. But, you know, we have heard, well, we're fighting for all the rights for all the people. But the Scottish Government has already committed to agreeing with the UNCRPD. And yet, well, we can't do that. And we know that there's all the legal stuff and everything around there. But it's like, well, OK, but we'll maybe get there at that point, you know, later on. It's like, fight for us now, because yet again, we're being ignored in that point. And then when you take on all the stories that we all know about people's human rights being degraded, ignored, discrimination happening, and all the dignity and choice and control that disabled people are meant to have in their lives, as non-disabled people have, is just ignored, and there is no control and there is no choice and there is no dignity at times as well. So do we need a figurehead? We shouldn't really. We shouldn't really need a figurehead at all. Our First Minister should be our figurehead. His cabinet should be our figurehead. Our elected officials should be our figurehead. for shining the light on disabled people, and therefore other organisations that are there to do the work would have that light shone on them as well.
The interesting question. I totally agree with what you're saying, but I think that there are all sorts of resources out there that if you had a disability minister, a disability commissioner, would be able to use and enforce. I mean, we have standards up the yin-yang, and they are set and developed by a whole range of organisations, but they're still not delivered. And I think it's about, I think what you're saying there is about putting a spotlight on what we already have. I mean, I would hope that if we did have a commissioner, we wouldn't be reinventing, we would just be looking at what we already have, but we would be making sure that they are enacted. And I think that's the big issue that we have. We had an issue with the death review, which is absolutely amazing, because now, after many, many decades of never reviewing a child with a profound learning disability, we review their deaths, and that's why we've had no progress, and that's why we don't plan for life, because we've always been expecting them to die. But when we had a review that didn't go as well as it maybe should, we had the most amazing standards and resources, but nobody was able to enforce each local authority to use what the tools that they were given. And so actually harm was done, because a family was contacted without going through the right process. But actually, we approached Health Improvement Scotland and said, look, you know, you've got a standard there, you've developed the resources, you need to enforce it. But nobody seems to feel they have the power to enforce best practice. And I think that's what we're looking for, is somebody that can take all of the resources that we have and make sure they actually get enacted. And if they don't get enacted, there needs to be some recourse, because we spend millions of pounds developing fantastic practice in Scotland, and yet we don't sometimes have the impetus to actually put it there. And I think our hope would be that a commissioner, an LDAN commissioner, a physical disability commissioner, would be able to absolutely make sure that these things are enforced and be given the authority to ask the questions about why not, and then not be a, well, so what are you going to do? We need to make sure that things that should be there are there.
Anyone else want to come in?
Heather?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Sorry, just waiting for my captions. Thank you. Sorry about that. So I really agree with what Lynn has said, and I won't repeat it for time. What I would do, though, in the sense of this idea that it's too big, yeah, it's massive. I think we've said that quite clearly. But there's another angle there that I want to add. Over the last decade, we've had some very sudden pressures that have had massive impact on disabled people and have meant that our DPOs have had to change tack really suddenly and very drastically. So we had COVID and then the cost of living crisis. And it just changed everything. We had to react so quickly. And a commissioner is going to have to do the same, likewise. And it goes back, I think, to this point I made earlier about working with disabled people's organisations and actually recognising the UN definition of what a disabled organisation is that's set out in the CRPD General Comment 7. But to summarise, it's massive. It covers every aspect of life. And of course, disabled people aren't a homogeneous group. And we've spoken about intersectional barriers, socioeconomic issues, and the fact that we've got the Equality Act. And we're looking at an incorporation act for human rights in Scotland. But unfortunately, the UNCRPD is not going to be fully incorporated into Scots law through these proposals. There will only be due regard or requirement to give due regard, which really isn't strong enough. But that's a different conversation. But yes, it's a really big ask for one person in the sense of champion. And disabled people are their own champions. We don't need somebody to inspire other people. The law is there. We have our rights. We just need our rights to be delivered in a way that ensures our choice, control, dignity and freedom to exercise our right to independent living in society in Scotland. Thank you.
Thanks.
As well, in your question, you said obviously this is, it's an awful lot for one person to take on. A disability commissioner, it'd be a huge amount for one individual. And so perhaps is it like, you know, the SHRC or something else kind of looking at whether they need to step in more? And listening to the evidence from the commissioners last week that you heard, I thought it was quite, and obviously there's the review going on around the commission, the Finance and Public Administration Commission that are doing that review. And the SHRC were suggesting that, you know, they see deficiencies in the powers that they have, in the role that they can take on, particularly around, you mentioned, like, participation and so on. So perhaps is it maybe too much to be expecting them to take on, you know, perhaps a stronger role for focusing on disabled people until, you know, they're talking about having to have more legislative change to make, you know, their role stronger or so on. So, you know, that takes time. And so is it, again, just a case of, well, you know, bide your time. You know, we're not going to have a disability commissioner, but we don't really have the kind of strength and remit that we need to have a stronger focus on disability at the moment, but that will come. So again, it's just that, you know, as Lynn said, it's always that kind of that sense of, you know, well, when is it going to be? When, if not now, when? So,
can I also just add to that as well, that I know you used the term figurehead, and I just want to be really clear, we don't want a tokenistic figurehead, we want a champion, and it's not just one person, it's a team, and I really don't mind if that team is put at the SHRC or if it's better on its own. We know obviously that needs to all be worked out, but it needs to be a team of skilled people with the right powers, so it shouldn't all be on one person. I think it's already set up to fail if we think it's on the shoulders of one person. It needs to be about systemic change, and it needs to be a team driving that, but it needs to be more resourced, I think, than the financial memorandum is suggesting.
And can I also ask, Tracy, you spoke at one point about what if this fails? And what if? What if this doesn't happen? How do we fill in the gaps that you've told us about? How do we strengthen powers of other organisations? And what would that look like?
If the Commissioner fails?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so
if
well,
this does
I'm
not,
just,
if this
so
does
I
not
think
happen.
We need a full-scale systemic change of the whole of society. So we're talking about transformational change. We would need to properly implement and deliver public sector reform. We need better collaboration. We need a focus on prevention. We need to implement Christie's principles. We need to fully resource DPOs. And we need, I feel very strongly, as do the other DPOs, that we need the incorporation to be about a duty to comply with the human rights of disabled people as outlined in the UNCRPD. So there's not a quick fix for this. It is going to take time, and disabled people are impatient to see that there is going to be progress made, but they're not unrealistic in thinking that it's all going to happen overnight. But we need a plan, and we need timescales, and we need politicians, the Cabinet in Scotland, and all these institutions also working together to prioritise disabled people because their rights are so far removed.
Well, I think we definitely need a power shift, and without wishing to be politically incorrect, but the power that COSLA has, we find as an organisation incredibly difficult. You know, being able to make a decision about enacting something that saves people's lives, being put down to whether parties agree that, that was once said about introducing health passports, that health checks, well, we'd need to check what our members think. Well, if the evidence tells you that it saves lives, you need to enact that. So I think we need to make sure that the power is with all of us and that we all have a right to make suggestions. But I certainly we feel with the group that we support, you know, they need to plan for life and they need to be expected to live, but they hit adulthood. They hit adulthood now, but there are no services for them because everybody expected that they would die and everybody accepted that the mortality rates, which was shocking, but that's what you expect. But we need to change that power shift so that we can use the evidence and that we hold people to account when they don't take best practice forward.
Thanks, Camilla.
Thank you, Evelyn. And I know we're running very short of time here, but I would like to ask a question in regards to the provision for inclusive communication in the bill and what that may look like. And if I could ask for your thoughts on that, if I could please come to Heather.
Yeah, it's incredibly important. There's no doubt about that. Having that on the basis of it would be incredibly important for people, not just deaf people, people who are visually impaired, but also for people who have speech impediments. There's a whole range of communication issues. And that's not to put these particular issues on a higher plane than you would. The barriers that other people face, I think one of the most important things to say is that communication is not one way, communication is two way. And I saw that in the policy memorandum, and that's welcomed. And also to look back to what was said earlier about capacity building, it's not just the physical act of making yourself understood, it's also people's own understanding of the issue in hand. Not everybody comes with a policy background to our webinars for members, etc. So you've got a capacity building issue there. One other thing to say is that there is an absolute dearth of supply of communication support in Scotland of particular types, and that's something that potentially needs addressed as well. So the role may be there to supply communication support, but it is not available to provide. And the other thing, and it's an experience of all our DPOs, is that sometimes when Scottish Government issue a consultation or a paper, we have to go back and say, well, hold on, we need this an easy read at the same time. Otherwise, it's not inclusive. So that's a very quick answer, taking account of the time. Thank you.
Thank you, Heather. Would anyone else like to come in on that?
Lynn. Okay. Yeah, I agree with what Heather is saying around there. We need to think about that two-way approach, because we can be really good at putting inclusive communication out to include people, not so good when we get it back in again in that regard. So we need to look at inclusive communication as in the principles that Scottish Government have adopted and kind of enforce that in that regard. But we need to be able to say it's how that communication comes back from disabled people, from DPOs, from other organisations. You know, when reports are done, great, wonderful, but actually it's not inclusive because of the way it's written. It's written in a kind of researchy manner often, and that's not what disabled people want necessarily, but it excludes a lot of people. If they are told that they have to go online to do something and they are uncomfortable doing that, or they don't have the facility to do that, where is the phone number to be able to get the information? And often, and I'm talking about services here, often people do call a number and they're told, oh, just go online and do that. And the reason they're calling is because they can't access the online or it's complicated. And we also know that different impairments across individuals, often when they're faced with something that causes a barrier, they don't know how to react. They don't know what kind of response they're going to get. So they just turn around and walk away. So they don't have their voice shared. They don't get on that bus. They don't go into that building. They don't make an appointment. They don't fill a form in because it's just too complicated. You know, when we look at the information that comes out for applying for benefits and everything, sometimes it's long and long and long. You know, with Social Security Scotland, that's changed slightly, but it's still a long process for somebody to sit and go through in that way. And often the questions that are asked or the information that's given is often confusing. So we want to make it as inclusive as possible, but we need the responses to come back. And that's attitudes as well as the physical ability to pass information back. But yeah, we support this the six principles that the Scottish Government set, and we do that with all our work that we have. So we want to make sure that Disability Commissioner, whatever, and that hopefully would butterfly effect out to the other commissioners that they're working alongside and other organisations as well.
Thank you, Lynn.
I just think Tressa mentioned, you know, working with disabled people, they're the ones that will often come up with the solutions. And I know we find with family carers, they'll tell you how to make things more accessible. So I think actually that involvement and making it a two-way process really supports.
Thank you. Are there any other members who wish to come in with a question? No.
Okay, that brings us to the conclusion of our first panel today. I want to thank you all very much for your testimonies today, and we will now suspend briefly till we go to the second panel. Thank you. We will now take evidence from our second panel today, and I welcome to the meeting Jamie Cook, Head of Policy and Communications in ABLE, Susie Martin, External Affairs Manager, National Autistic Society Scotland, Alice Struthers, Programme Director, Neurological Alliance of Scotland, and Eddie McConnell, Chair, Scottish Commission for People with Learning Disabilities. You're all very welcome, and thank you for attending this morning. We're quite tight for time, so we'll move straight into questions. And I'll kick off and ask you, what are your views on the bill, and do you support the general principles of it? And I'll come to Jamie first, please.
Thank you. Yes, as Enable, we definitely support the intention and the view behind the bill. We see definitely the need for further support for enhancing and delivering on the rights that people with disabilities do have and should have within Scotland. And so we are very strongly supporting the bill in that sense. I think for us, obviously, particularly working with people with learning disabilities, we also recognise that that's a further community that is quite often further excluded within that. The statistics show levels of death and exclusion from the workplace and from universities being much higher. So I think we also, recognising that the Learning Disability Autism Neurodivergence Bill is being looked at as well, see the need for ensuring that part of the community is further supported and developed through any of the work that's taken forward and not simply taken for granted within the wider setting there.
Okay, thank you. Susie, please.
Hi, yeah, thank you for the opportunity to speak to committee today. We also, you know, agree with the principles of the bill and the intent of the bill, and we understand why Jeremy Balfour has brought forward this bill and pay tribute to the work that he's done for disabled people during his time in Parliament and continues to do, and a lot of work has gone into this bill, so we pay tribute to that work and his staff. So as I say, yeah, we agree with the principles of the bill and the intent of the bill, and we do think that further work is needed to protect and promote the rights of all disabled people. As you'll be aware, the Learning Disability Autism and Neurodivergence Bill has been consulted on, and there was a proposal in the consultation for a commission or commissioner for people with learning disabilities, autistic people and neurodivergent people. And similarly to what Jamie said, we believe that there is good reason to have a specific commissioner for autistic people, people with learning disabilities and neurodivergent people. Often those individuals can be overlooked when a more generalist approach is taken and when a pan-disability approach is taken, and the outcomes speak to that. So we think there is a real need for a focus on that specific community. But we do agree with the intention of the bill and the principles of the bill and understand why Jeremy Balfour has brought it forward.
Okay, thank you. Alice, please.
Thank you. So I'm here representing the Neurological Alliance of Scotland, and we're a membership organisation of 55 charity members. And we are fully supportive of the call for a disability commissioner in Scotland. In a sense, we believe that the need for a dedicated disability commissioner shows the level of the lack of care that people with disabilities are getting currently from authorities, and essentially people feeling that their individual and collective voice is just being ignored at the moment. So we're fully supportive of that. We are worried about the cluttered landscape. I know this is something that's come up quite a lot. And we do worry slightly that the remit lacks teeth, but we stand by the principle that it is needed here in Scotland.
Thank you. Eddie, please.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for the opportunity. So SALD supports the policy intent of this proposed bill. People with learning disabilities tell us on a daily basis that the status quo is not acceptable, and that their lived experience of, on a daily basis, experiencing abuse, discrimination and continual injustice has to end. So we support the policy intent of this bill. And to be brief, I'll just say I support the comments made by my colleagues on the panel.
Okay, thank you. We'll now move on to questions from Maggie Chapman, please.
Thanks very much, Karen, and good morning to you all. Thank you for joining us this morning and for your comments so far. Alice, I think you talked about the cluttered landscape and the potential that we've heard in previous sessions, and we've heard around potential confusion for people. You know, if a disabled person wants to go to somebody to seek redress if they are not being able to realise their rights, you know, would they go to the Scottish Human Rights Commission, the Equalities and Human Rights Commission, the Disability Commissioner? And I just wondered how... What your views are on that cluttered landscape, on these different commissioners potentially working alongside each other with overlapping and or maybe duplicated mandates, how you would see that working out?
Yeah, we would agree that we're edging towards a cluttered and expensive commissioner landscape. And in fact, there is no sort of evidence to demonstrate the efficacy of having commissioners really in terms of where they work for everyone. And there's a real risk of overlap. I note that the EHRC and the SHRC currently have responsibility for reviewing legislation impacting disabled people. However, we are supportive of the idea of an introduction of a disability commissioner because they will have responsibility for all disabilities and without focus on any single condition and having a sort of condition agnostic disability commissioner who can pull evidence together across a whole spectrum of long-term conditions would be able to see the bigger picture for what's going wrong. And I think for us, it's focusing on the barriers that impact on disabled people and looking across all disabilities would be a way of doing that really successfully. There is a cluttered landscape, that there is no doubt about that. And I note there are more commissioners in the pipeline as well. So I think looking at the roles, the remits, making sure that there's memorandums of understanding and so on, that's all very important and has to be factored in right at the beginning, mm-hmm. Rather than carving something up and trying to work out who does what. There's a risk of more time being spent on working out who's got responsibility within the commissions, let alone the people who have the disabilities wanting to seek help. So I would agree, you're absolutely right, it is cluttered.
So and when you say, you know, people working together across commissions, having information sharing, do you see any potential issue with different commissioners having different levels of authority, levels of power? Because we know that the SHRC at the moment, within its mandate, it can't take enforcement action, for instance. And yet they propose, you know, as you say, there are proposals for different commissioners. We could argue, well, that means the powers that the existing ones have are not sufficient and aren't being used, or all the powers they have are not being used effectively. How do you see potential differences of authority or mandate across different commissioners?
Well, I think that it's important that there isn't a hierarchy of commissioners and commissions, the remits of the commissions just have to be very well understood and clear, but it should be collaborative. It should be working together intersectionally and understanding where things meet and need support from each other. We heard from the previous session about the importance of joint working collaboration and how perhaps a commissioner model is not the right one at all, but it's essentially needing to have disabled people need to have a commissioner. I think there's no doubt in our minds at Neurological Alliance that is the case. How they work that one out, I think it is complicated.
Okay, no thanks. Eddie, if I can come to you, same kind of question. How do we deal with the potential problems, confusions that duplication of work, of mandate and overlap might result if this disability commissioner does go forward?
Yes, I think it's a fair question. You know, I would view it slightly differently, mm-hmm. you know, because people with learning disabilities and their families, their daily experience is complexity and a really complex landscape that isn't user-friendly to them. Yeah. So they know about complexity and they unfortunately spend most of their lives fighting that complexity and struggling to get their human rights recognised and respected. So my view and the view of SALD would be that, you know, a disability commissioner could actually cut through that. And I would invite the committee to think of that as a possibility, that it doesn't necessarily need to be the case that a disability commissioner would add to the complexity. It could actually, if properly framed and actively involving people with learning disabilities, it could actually use that experience to cut through the complexity and the landscape, and could actually be a beacon within what is undoubtedly a challenging landscape at the moment.
And that's interesting. And I suppose, given what you've all described and what we've heard earlier this morning and previously, other failures of commissioners, of other structures, support organisations, governments, to deal with some of the inequalities. I think you talked about the abuse, discrimination and continued injustices that disabled people face. You think that this focus, this office or person or resource would be really, really instrumental in transforming that?
SALD believes that for the community that it represents and listens to, people with learning disabilities, that anything like a disability commissioner that actually places a really sharp focus on their needs and their injustices and their human rights can actually only be a good thing. We are concerned that for the particular community that we are involved with, people with learning disabilities, a pan-disability approach, as is advocated mm-hmm. by this bill, could mean that we're at the back of the queue again, because that's often the experience that we have, people with learning disabilities, is mm-hmm. that we often find ourselves at the back of the queue. So I think there is more to be done in this bill to articulate how that would be avoided okay. and how people with learning disabilities would be seen as equal to all disabled people and advance probably at a faster rate, because they are undoubtedly the group within a pan-disability environment whose rights are most at risk.
Okay, thanks. That's helpful. Eddie, if I can come to you, Susie, you were nodding there as Eddie was talking. What are your thoughts on this?
Yeah, I just want to touch on a couple of things, and I think you've raised some really interesting issues, Maggie. First of all, I want to touch on the idea that it's a confusing landscape, and I think Eddie's point that disabled people, and in particular autistic people, and people with learning disabilities deal with complexity every day is a mm-hmm. really good one. And I think that the idea that people will be confused by introducing something that is specifically for them in name is a bit bizarre to me, to be honest. And I also mm-hmm. think that actually, if an autistic person goes to, in the future, what I hope will be a learning disability, autism and neurodivergence commissioner, and it turns out that maybe the Children Young People's Commissioner is better placed to deal with that particular issue or is already working on that particular issue, I would hope that it's not the beyond the wit of our existing commissioner landscape for a referral to happen behind the scenes. Okay. And for that person to then be, you know, given the appropriate advice and guidance and for action to be taken quickly, and for them to be put to the right commissioner or the right body that they should be in touch with. I would hope that that is not beyond the wit of the existing commissioner landscape. So I push back on this idea of complexity and the idea that something specifically for autistic people, specifically for disabled people, would somehow increase complexity. Mm-hmm. And I think if this commissioner were to come forward, there would need to be memorandums of understanding. And I think that is really important. So that's the first point. On duplication and the idea of duplication and different mandates and potential hierarchies, well, first of all, what I would say is that certainly from the perspective of autistic people, if we were to have a commissioner for autistic people with learning disabilities, there would be no duplication, because the existing bodies that we're talking about are not really doing any focus work on this community. And where they have done focus work, you know, they've maybe done one report in a period of 10 years. Mm-hmm. You know, when we look at the current strategy for the Scottish Human Rights Commission, I think autism or autistic people are mentioned once. Children Young People's Commissioner in their strategy, I don't believe autism or autistic children young people are mentioned at all. And that's, you know, not a direct criticism. Those bodies are set up to deal with, you know, all people in Scotland, as is the case for the SHRC, and all children and young people. Mm-hmm. And, you know, they have to deal with those whole groups of populations. But that does put people with learning disabilities and autistic people at a disadvantage, and it always has done. And that is our concern. And I think when it comes to different mandates, actually, we've seen when that has worked really effectively. So again, I would push back on the idea that is inherently a bad thing. Mm-hmm. So the Children Young People's Commissioner worked with the Equality and Human Rights Commission on restraint. So they pulled the levers, the different levers that they have to achieve change mm-hmm. and to get the ball rolling on what will hopefully be eventually a legal framework around restraint and seclusion. So again, I would push back a bit that that is inherently a bad thing, but I think it is important that there's collaboration as opposed to duplication. And the last thing I want to talk about is just that idea that, you know, the lack of evidence around commissioners being effective. There are things that are happening at a macro level that commissioners cannot hope to influence. And I think it's really important that we understand that a commissioner isn't going to equal immediate change. Commissioners are there to leverage change. And they're always going to be a few steps back from the change that happens. So I think we just need to be, you know, understand that there are macro things happening. And I think looking at recent evidence sessions in other committees, the commissioners have had a grilling. But I think it's important that we do understand that they're doing really good work, and often it's under the surface, often it's behind the scenes, often it's, you know, strategic litigation, it's testing the law, and it is about providing advice and guidance to families and individuals. So they're the main points I wanted to make.
No, thank you, Susie, that's really helpful. You touched in part of your answer there on what I interpret as intersectionality and understanding the multiple identities that any one person can hold. And you know, you said disabled person might also be a young person, might also be an older person. Do you think that it's through that a very, very clear framework or structure, however it's designed, of collaboration, of communication, that we deal with those intersectional issues and have, as you say, that sort of internal referral, if I can use internal in that way, internal referral processes? Do you think that deals with some questions or potential potential problems by, you know, wanting to take an intersectional approach, but then missing a really, really vital need over here because we're looking over here at a different picture?
Yeah, I think so. And I think it's about complementarity and addressing the gaps as opposed to necessarily overly worrying about overlap. I mean, for our communities, it's about the gaping holes in the system. It's not about, you know, oh, it's a problem that there's a slight overlap here. And I think what's really interesting about the intersectionality issue, I think what you've described does address that in part, but I think we also have to understand that specifically thinking about autism, there is widespread misunderstanding of what autism is and what it means to be autistic. But there's also increasing awareness, and that's leading to a lot of really big issues, big problems. And I think that we see autistic people at the moment doing the work of training professionals, of educating the public, and it shouldn't be their role, and the public sector and public bodies need to be stepping up. So for us, when it comes to intersectionality is important. It's about addressing those gaps though, and for us there's a big gap when it comes to autism understanding and acceptance, and there's nothing that's filling that gap at the moment because the bodies that we have do often take a generalist approach to human rights, and as Eddie has described, people with learning disabilities, autistic people, often end up at the back of that queue.
Okay, thanks, Susie. Jamie, if I can come to you, same kind of question about how you view the potential for dealing with overlap, duplication, notwithstanding what Susie said about the gaping holes in provision.
Absolutely, and I think very eloquently put by my colleagues here on the panel already, and I would agree with what's been said. I think for me there's a few key things. I don't think we get a cluttered landscape if there's clarity. So I think if we have each commission that we have in whatever shape or sense being very clear about its own roles and how they interact, then that starts to reduce that clutter. It isn't clutter if we have the correct number of different agencies and commissions producing. I think the clutter comes about when we create silos. So my concern and concern at Enable about any specific commissioner is if they are actually just put in a corner as you're just here as the learning disability, autism, neurodivergence, and we'll only talk to you when that comes about. As we've all touched on, the intersectionality, the impact around social deprivation, around education, around health, around so many different areas, has to ensure that they're part of those conversations. You touched on hierarchy of commissioners, mm-hmm. and actually I think there's a role within some of these commissioners that we're talking about as well, of not only keeping effectively government and politicians and society honest, but also keeping other commissioners honest, having that role that they can play together there, mm-hmm. Which I think is then a chance to actually enhance the impact and the role of the commissions and commissioners that we already have in place by actually helping to expand that impact. I think, as has been touched on already, when you're dealing with human rights in its entirety, when you're dealing with children and young people in their entirety, it's such a huge, broad section of society that we need that ability for the specific focus for people who are being left behind just now. I also think there's something very important about, whilst the role of commissioner is important, that we're not solely focusing on an individual. This isn't one person, as has been touched on, who's going to magically mm-hmm. come in and fix everything. They will be building into an ecosystem that already exists, that you're hearing support from and evidence from already. So I think there's already an environment out there that will support and contribute to the work of the commissioner. It's about how they provide that focal point to be able to take some of that forward. Mm-hmm. I think the final thing I would maybe put in just to build on that is also it's an evolutionary process. So we're not discussing here introducing something that will never be looked at again in future. We're already reviewing the impact and the current status of commissioners and commissions. Ideally, it was covered in the last session, we wouldn't need commissioners because actually we would have these ideas championed through every piece of work. So ideally, if we can get to a situation where having this as a way of driving that change leads to the change and not needing it in future, it's an ongoing process that you can review how those interactions function with each other over time.
Thanks, all. That's really helpful. I'll leave it there.
Thank you. We now have questions from Paul, please.
Thank you very much, convener. And before I begin my questions, it was remiss of me earlier not to declare or to draw attention to my register of interests, having been employed by Enable Scotland until 2021. I'm keen to expand on the previous discussion with the panel, if I can. Obviously, you are all organisations who have been across the detail of or involved in the campaign for a learning disability, autism, neurodiverse bill, and indeed a commissioner potentially within that process as well. So I suppose, building on what you have said about the interaction of commissioners, what are your views in terms of how a disability commissioner and a potential LDAN commissioner may interact? And would you have concerns about siloed working, as I think you've referred to, or things becoming so broad that we don't have the specialism that's required? I don't know who wants to start with that large question. Susie?
Yeah, happy to go in. As I say, you know, we understand why this bill has been brought forward, and we agree with the principles and the intent of the bill. If there was to be a disability commissioner, which we've said in our written response, you know, we would, and there was also an LDAN commissioner, we would expect there to be a memorandum of understanding. I think for us, again, it would be about addressing a gap, and I think that, as has already been said, you know, we have concerns that autistic people's rights would not be sufficiently addressed or focused on. There would not be sufficient resource put behind promoting and protecting autistic people's rights, potentially within a more generalist or pan-disability context. And therefore, we do feel like there is a really good argument when you look at the outcomes for a specific commissioner. And I think that if that were to be the case and there were to be two commissioners, there probably would have to be quite close collaboration and close working and an understanding about, particularly when consultation has taken place and strategies are being drafted and published, what it is that these individual commissioners are planning on, you know, what their key priorities are over a certain period of time, to ensure that they aren't duplicating, they're complementing one another and potentially working with one another to achieve positive social change where they can. So I think that answers maybe part of your question, Paul.
Anyone else want to come in on this, Eddie?
Thank you. Thank you, Paul. SALD, its first priority is supporting the government's stated aim to bring forward a learning disability, autism and neurodivergence bill. But we don't have the detail of that, of course, in front of us. We've only recently completed the consultation process, so it will be interesting to see what comes forward in the bill in due course, the draft bill. At the SALD, we talk more about the need for accountability measures than we talk. We emphasise that point more than whether there should be a commission or a commissioner in terms of the LDAM bill. We are very clear in our minds from talking to people with learning disabilities and their families that this is their single greatest frustration, is that people and organisations and public authorities appear not to be held to account for the absolute dereliction of their duties in terms of upholding their human rights. So it's absolutely imperative that accountability measures come, new accountability measures come forward, so that people's rights are amplified as well as actually protected and safeguarded. If we were in a situation, it's a bit of a scenario, but if we were in a situation where an LDAN commissioner was coming forward as well as a disability commissioner, it is absolutely imperative that there is close cooperation and dialogue, and that I couldn't envisage a situation where either commissioner or commission addressed their remits without that close and really tight collaboration going forward. It's a bit speculative, of course, because we don't have the detail and we don't have the proposals in front of us in terms of an LDAN bill and ideas around a commissioner. But our fundamental point would be that we have to deliver greater accountability for the continuing injustices that people in our community, people with learning disabilities and disabled people more generally, continue to live with day in, day out. So some form of accountability measure needs to be properly introduced. And in that regard, we would probably say that the bill, in terms of the Disability Commissioner Bill that's at the focus of this discussion, probably needs to go further in terms of its powers, in terms of holding people to account beyond just carrying out an investigation or an inquiry, but actually go further to ensure that the recommendations and any proposals from any such inquiries are actually enacted. That feels like full accountability rather than partial accountability.
PAMIS and some of the evidence that they brought raised concerns that this bill could jeopardise the LDAN bill or the success of that bill. I mean, is that a view that would be shared by people on the panel, or would you not see the risks in that? Bring Susie in.
Thank you. I wouldn't necessarily see this bill as posing a risk to the proposals for a learning disability, autism and neurodivergence commissioner. I think as Parliament has recognised, and we know the Finance Committee is looking at this, there are multiple calls across various sectors for commissioners, which speaks to, you know, the what we have termed accountability gap, some have termed a kind of implementation gap. And so I think, you know, these calls are coming from potentially similar places. And again, that's why we understand and agree with the intent and the principle of this bill. But we wouldn't necessarily see it as a risk. I think also because we have very, very strong evidence that about the outcomes of autistic people and people with learning disabilities. But we have also, and I think it's worth really emphasising this, a lot of work has been done on the LDAN bill, and specifically looking at the possibility of a commissioner over a number of years since 2021. So as you know very well, Paul, we campaigned for this in the run-up to the 2021 election, and a commissioner appeared in several party manifestos and then ended up in the Scottish Government's programme for government that year in 2021. And since then, there's been a large-scale scoping exercise where autistic people with learning disabilities were consulted. There has been a lived experience advisory panel which agreed that accountability is really important, and it was kind of top of their list of things that, you know, really this bill really needed to address. And there has been a very large public consultation, and we're waiting on the analysis of the responses to that. So I think it's worth just putting that in context, that this bill, which includes, you know, proposals for a commissioner, has had a lot of work go into it. And we have heard from autistic people with learning disabilities, and we're going to hear more from them through that consultation process. And it's really important that Parliament listens to what autistic people and people with learning disabilities are saying they want the bill to achieve and what they want from a commissioner. So for me, all of that work and the fact that we've gotten this far is really important for us to recognise. And our own research by the National Autistic Society and Scottish Autism indicated that out of over 1,000 autistic people, family members and professionals, 96% supported the concept of a specific commissioner. So we know there is really strong support out there, as well as having that key kind of foundation that builds the argument that, you know, the outcomes are very poor for autistic people, people with learning disabilities. 5 times more likely to be excluded from school. Only less than 1 in 5 autistic people are actually in employment. They're more likely to die earlier from preventable illnesses. And the mental health of autistic people is very, very poor. And also we know that there are over 300 people in institutional settings experiencing either delayed discharge or when they shouldn't be in those settings. So the outcomes, I think, also speak for themselves.
I think Eddie would just like to add something.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you, Paul, for the question. If I recollect it correctly, you were asking whether we had a view on the view expressed by the organisation PAMIS, with whom we work very closely. So I think, as I said in my earlier remarks, SCLD supports any initiative that is going to throw a greater spotlight on improving the rights of disabled people in general, and particularly for our community of people with learning disabilities. We know, and it's self-evident, that disabled people is not a homogenous group, and within that, we recognise that people with learning disabilities often find themselves very much a marginalised group within the broader disability population. So that's, I think, where the concern comes from, in that the Disability Commissioner Bill, for us at the moment, doesn't address that particular issue of how people with learning disabilities would be particularly protected and prioritised. So in that sense, I suppose SCLD would share the concerns that in the absence of that specificity and clarity in the bill, that a pan-disability approach may result in people with learning disabilities finding themselves once again at the back of the queue. And we would argue quite strongly and robustly that all of the evidence over many years and the lived experience of people with learning disabilities is that they are the people, the particular group, the particularly marginalised group whose rights are most at risk. And it seems to us that if you wish to address a marginalised group whose rights are at risk, you have to put unequal effort into that group to bring them from a page called inequality to a page called equality. It requires unequal effort. And that's probably where we differ slightly to the view offered by the Scottish Human Rights Commission, and its kind of universal argument for all people, is that for us, the very marginalised group of people with learning disabilities, and even within that group, people with profound and multiple learning disabilities and people with Down syndrome, we know have particular needs and particular support. So we cannot adopt this homogenous approach. There is a need for us to understand the complexity of the population we're dealing with. And if we're truly about the business of addressing their human rights, then we need to understand that complexity.
Thank you. We have a supplementary from Megan, please.
Convener, and good morning, panel. We're just at good morning, panel. In terms of the questions that Paul O'Kane asked, I would like to touch upon what you've just said, Eddie, in relation to the powers of the Scottish Human Rights Commission. Because there has been concerns, we've heard the concerns from the previous panel this morning, in relation to sufficient powers and how disabled people always feel at the back of the queue when they're looking at that overarching commission that deals with a lot of various different issues and various different groups. And I'm just wondering, in terms of disabled people, why do they feel as though they're not being represented? And does the panel think that despite strengthening the roles of the SHRC, would that still mean that there is still a black hole there that disabled people will still not fit into? And is that why it is important to have a disability commissioner? And Eddie, sorry, I was looking at you there, so I'm going to hand over to you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Part of my response is going to be based on my own experience as a father of a young man with a learning disability, which I bring into play in my role as chair of SCLD every day. And I'm fairly clear that my experience of my son is that he will not be put up the queue. He will always find himself right at the back of the queue. So there is a real need to put a focus on the marginalised groups and understand what their needs are. Their needs are complex. That should not push us back from dealing with it just because their needs are complex. In fact, we should be more inquisitive and more determined to understand that complexity, because if we understood that complexity, as I said earlier, we could cut through the unintended, cluttered complexity that's happening elsewhere. In relation to the SHRC and other organisations, because there are other commissions that exist with powers at the moment, it's not been the experience of people with learning disabilities that their rights have advanced as a consequence of those. And that's not to suggest that there's a disinterest. These organisations do very good work, very good work. But they are universal in their approach, and particularly I think the SHRC have set that out, that their approach is to address the human rights of the general population. We would argue that that universal approach will only serve to continue to keep people with learning disabilities further back and not have their rights properly addressed. In an ideal world, we would say that any disability commissioner, or indeed any LDAN commissioner that might emerge in due course, cannot do all of this work alone. The sheer complexity and demand of the work involved, the sheer history of abuse and discrimination, requires a sector-wide and a society-wide approach to this. So I can't imagine a situation where a disability commissioner working with and for disabled people, or an LDAN commissioner working for that particular community, could really move the agenda forward without a really tight and close collaboration with the Scottish Human Rights Commission. And it may well be that there are elements that they are actually better placed to advance, and they would really value, I believe, the expertise and the specific knowledge of certainly the learning disability community in their work. So I actually see this as a really reinforcing relationship and not an either-or. Yeah. I would much prefer us to view it as an opportunity to really shift the dial in terms of disabled people in Scotland by, yes, understanding the Disability Commissioner role in all of this, but understanding it's within the context of the current provisions, the current standards, the current work, and the need to drive all of that really powerfully forward in a collaborative way.
Thank you. I'm just wondering if the panel have any other... Yes, Alice, thank you.
Yeah, thank you. I would agree with everything Eddie said here, but just in terms of neurological conditions, there are an estimated 600 different neurological conditions, and you wouldn't necessarily say that just because someone has a neurological condition that they have a disability, but neurological conditions in of themselves can be very disabling. And so one of the problems we have with recognising where to go for help is that if you don't recognise yourself to be disabled, to have a disability, then where do you go for help? And the benefit of having a disability commissioner would be to have that role, that champion, that clearly outlined figurehead who would... You know, there are obviously advantages and disadvantages to being pan disability, and we've stated our own thoughts about that in the written evidence about needing someone to understand the nuances between each condition and how not to apply personal experience particularly to your understanding of someone else's disability. But I think for us it's having that focus and having a champion. There's a bit about the Equality Act as well, and perhaps using, as I was saying in my opening statement, just the you know, really having an ableist world that we live in is part of the problem. So it's not just in of itself enough to depend on that as a definition in terms of your ability to then to investigate and put things forward. We feel that having a disability commissioner, even if the powers of the SHRC were to be opened up, would still be of value.
Thank you. Jamie, thank you.
Thanks. Yeah, I think you're going to get a lot of agreement across us. But I think there's recognising that all of our organisations work from a basis of human rights. So we're all firmly committed to and contributing to the development of that. I think it is that additionality of what the specific focus can bring. The SHRC, as it stands, even with enhanced powers, to cover that entire scope and that environment is probably not to be fully expected. You know, to really see where we're that idea of accountability, of follow-up. We have laws, we have rights in place. It's their delivery, it's their accountability, it's finding things, how we deal with them when they go wrong. And I think having that specific focus actually feeds into, and as Eddie said, enhances the impact of the SHRC. It gives that space, that overarching recognition of the human rights-based approach that we want to see across society, but ensures that our communities are not left out just through the sheer scope of the population being dealt with. So I actually think that by looking at the LDAN Commissioner, the Disability Commissioner, we really are offering that enhancement of the work that the SHRC could be doing and delivering through that specialist knowledge and follow-up.
Thank you. And Susie?
Yeah, I'll try to be brief. We wouldn't say no to the SHRC having more powers and enhanced powers. I think that would be a good thing. However, we would have the same concerns that we currently have about a potential lack of focus on autistic people and people with learning disabilities. And I think that for us, it's really important, and the benefit of a specific commissioner is that that would be on the statute book and it would be in law that there is a commissioner for this specific group of individuals. I know that the SHRC has talked about legislative change in order to enable it to internally have commissioners or rapporteurs that are specific to different populations. But I imagine the legislative change wouldn't result in autistic people and people with learning disabilities being in legislation. Mm-hmm. You know, I think that that would be then be and still be an internal decision as to how much focus, how much resource, how much time is given to that population of individuals. So I think I just want to flag that for autistic people and families, it's really important that that body is there, and there's a legal duty for that body to consult them and to protect and promote their rights.
Thank you very much, panel. Thank you, convener.
Thank you. We now have questions from Marie, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. And obviously you'll know from sitting in the previous panel that we're looking to sort of hear your thoughts about, you know, the financial and resource estimates attached to the financial memorandum. And I get a sense from our previous session that, you know, I think it's a huge underestimation, is that the £1 million, just really pop out there for your thoughts on that. Eddie, I'll pop it to yourself.
Thank you very much. So I think, am I allowed to say, I think the estimates are probably conservative. I think the particular concern, and I listened to some of the previous panels, so I won't repeat too much, but I think the particular concern the SCLD would offer to the committee is about the cost of ensuring meaningful participation, particularly by people with learning disabilities, within the work of the proposed Disability Commissioner. It requires a substantial investment of resources, but also time and skills to ensure that people are properly and meaningfully involved in this. I think the broader issue, we have a particular concern that there is insufficient resource allocated to that particular area. I think the broader issue about resources, notwithstanding my general observation, I think it's probably light, I think we would prefer to see us test those collaborations to see where resources are levered from other places too. There is existing level of resources that are targeted in this area. There are existing standards that we know that aren't being implemented. So there is actually already quite a lot of resource. It would be fantastic to think of a really focused role of Disability Commissioner or LDAN Commissioner being able to really lever those resources in the best interests mm-hmm. of the disabled people in general and people with learning disabilities in particular.
Thank you. Anyone else? Susie?
I would agree with what Eddie has said, that it's a conservative estimate, and I think I echo what was said in the previous panel around
the need to ensure that there's appropriate resources for engaging individuals meaningfully. And I think it's just to flag how we would, the role of a commissioner, what we would want to see from a commissioner would be that they would have to consult autistic people, people with learning disabilities and their families, protect and promote their human rights, conduct investigations and compel bodies to give evidence and ideally to compel them to follow through with recommendations. So there's that enforcement aspect as well, and also to promote good practice. So it's really important that all functions of a proposed commissioner are appropriately and adequately resourced. And I recognise that there's an ongoing inquiry by the Finance Committee into this landscape and the cost of this landscape. It is estimated by the Scottish Government that sort of things related to autism cost the Scottish economy £2.3 billion. And that is both in services but also in lost productivity due to unemployment, underemployment. So I think it's just worth flagging as well that although there will be running costs and an additional outlay for a commissioner, that we would see that as a very good investment and as part of an ecosystem that is designed to leverage change and leverage funding where it's needed most. In order to save money further down the line. We are in a situation at the moment, especially with, as I say, the misunderstanding around autism, the increasing awareness that autistic people regularly end up in crisis, and a lot of money is spent on dealing with crisis situations. And actually, there's an untenable human cost to that, but also an unsustainable economic cost to that, and it's about shifting that balance. So we would see it as a very positive investment in having a commissioner. So I just wanted to flag that as well. Thanks.
Thank you. Jamie?
Yes, just to agree, and I think that language of investment is so important, that this isn't just a cost. Of course, financials are critically important, but it's also about what that will do and bring and change in people's lives. I also think that it's looking at resource that goes beyond purely the financial. I think there's a resource of time. It's giving the space for this to actually be able to work and deliver, not expecting that somehow we've, you know, funded for a year and we're expecting everything to change tomorrow. We're talking about long-standing barriers to participation in society. These are going to take time. So I think you need the resource of time, of space, of giving that ability to make a difference, and recognising with some of those functions that, again, what is the wider setup and team look like? You know, as I said earlier, there's quite often the automatic function or focus on the person, whereas actually we see with the impact that's coming out of, you know, for children and young people, it's through that wider team as well, the resource around research, around enforcement, around legal awareness that is so critical to taking that forward. So I think having that sense of resources in the entirety within that longer time scale of seeing the kind of impact that they can drive, and looking at that then as an evolutionary process that you can review as it goes forward.
Thanks for that. Alice? Cheers.
Thank you. Yes, I just wanted to come in on that as well and agree that it's an investment. Interested to hear your stats, Susie, about the cost of autism. The estimated cost of neurological conditions across the UK is £96 billion. And that's just for 10 different neurological conditions. And that, again, half of that roughly is in lost productivity in the workplace and the impact on carers who also can't work full time potentially. I share my colleague here's concerns about the proposed setup being perhaps underwhelming of the office. The setup costs for the office, the budget and the staffing levels, and they might have minimal impact for disabled people as they stand. Just looking at the way it's to be set up. Not having participation staff, not having that legal staff, I think all of those things will hold back the ability of the commissioner to fulfil their role and make a real difference to people with disabilities. So I think, generally speaking, it's a very conservative estimate given to the Disability Commissioner Office. And as people have said in this session and in the session before, it can't just be a tick box exercise. It has to be a committed and desired set up in order to make a profound difference to people, and at the moment as it stands it feels like it might not achieve that.
Your comments. Thank you.
Questions now from Evelyn. Thanks.
Thanks, convener, and good afternoon, panel. Thanks for all your answers so far. Can you tell the committee what your views are on using the Equality Act disability definition in the bill? Jamie, do you want to go first?
Sure. I think from Enable's perspective, we recognise that using already recognised language helps to ensure, on one level at least, that the people we serve will be considered. But also we recognise that language used around impairment is not the language that the people we work with would recognise or wish to see used. And I think given that within the work around the LDAM bill just now, there's been a recognition and a clarity around using the language that people themselves wish and recognise, I think it's vitally important that that is incorporated as well. So yes, whilst it's important to use the legally recognised language, I think if it already seems to disconnect the people we serve from that work, then we're already running into those troubles of isolation and exclusion that we've touched on so often already.
Hi, yeah, thanks, Evelyn. I would agree with what Jamie said, and we see a similar thing with autistic individuals, that they don't necessarily see themselves reflected in the language that's used in the Equality Act, and there's many autistic people that do not identify as disabled or having a disability. So that does pose a problem in terms of isolating autistic people potentially from a body that, you know, would be designed to, you know, serve them or protect and promote their rights. So that would be a concern for us around, you know, how at the moment as drafted, the bill would capture all autistic people and serve all autistic people. So yeah, we would share the concerns that Jamie has outlined.
Does anyone else want to come?
Yeah, I'm in agreement with my colleagues here, but I think generally it's a great starting point, but it would be, we'd prefer there to be a more inclusive definition of disability. A more social model approach would be useful in terms of the Disability Commissioner.
Thank you. So the position of SCLD is that we're actually very uncomfortable with the use of the definition, the Equality Act definition, within this proposed bill. We would, because we see it as a deficit-based definition, and which relies very heavily on a medical model of disability. Mm-hmm. So we would advocate that there is a challenge to that to be brought about, and we would put forward a much broader, more inclusive definition aligned with the UN Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities. And we certainly advocate that as a much more appropriate, much more inclusive approach rather than a deficit-based model than that currently we believe the Equality Act definition perpetuates.
Okay, that's me, convener.
Thank you. That brings this session to a conclusion. Can I just ask if there's any other questions from members? If not, that's us came to the end. We will now, thank you for your participation, and we will now pause while we go into our private session. Thank you.